Right, we will get going. Hello and welcome to today's Ports webinar. Before we get going, we're just going to go through a couple of introductions. I'm Adam, part of the Enterprise Advocate team here at Ports Wigger, and I work with our trialists and customers to ensure that they get the most out of Birchwick Enterprise Edition. Also got Alex Borshik on the call today. Alex, introduce yourself, please.
Hello everyone, I'm Alex. I'm the technical product manager on the Burp Scanner team. I've been with Ports Wigger for about 5 years, and I basically look after all things scanner related.
Fantastic, thank you very much. We've also got Alex Simmons to my right, who's going to be running the demo today.
Yeah, hi folks. So, Second Alex here. I work on the tech support team. So, I cover our day-to-day support for enterprise, and we also help customers onboard.
Brilliant, thank you very much. We've also got James, Hannah, Sophie, and Maya in the background today, managing the Q&A facility in the Zoom toolbar. Please use this to ask any questions during the session. We'll try and respond to them all as quickly as we can, and we'll be picking out some of the questions to go through at the end during the Q&A. Finally, next session is going to be held on Wednesday, the 19th of October. So if you've got any colleagues that would benefit from attending, please let me know, and we can extend an invite. So as a quick recap of the agenda, today we're going to be discussing, we're going to do a very quick overview on the different versions of Burp Suite, Burp Suite Pro and Burp Suite Enterprise Edition, and how they use together. Then I'm going to hand over to Alex B for an update on the Burp Scanner. Following that, we'll touch on our licensing model, which will very nicely lead us into the product demo. That's going to feature an overview of deployment options, how to get scanning quickly, integration with CI/CD pipelines, amongst other things. I'm then going to give you a rundown on what's left on our 2022 roadmap. I'm going to quickly touch on our new deliberately vulnerable website before rounding off with the Q&A. So, Burp Suite products, many of you are going to be familiar with and likely use Burp Suite Pro. This is our manual penetration testing toolkit with features such as proxy, intruder, repeater. Burp Suite Enterprise Edition, Burp Suite Professional, both use the Burp Scanner that Alex is going to be giving us the update on. Burp Suite Enterprise Edition uses the scanner to carry out automated web vulnerability testing. These scans can be triggered by the inbuilt scheduler, or they could be triggered via an integration with a CI/CD pipeline, something Alex is going to demo later on in the session. The main reason we wanted to highlight this, it's often thought that Burp Suite Pro and Burp Suite Enterprise Edition are a tiered product set, Enterprise Edition sitting above Pro, when in fact, different products, different licensing model, and they are designed to be used to complement each other. So, Enterprise Edition is used for that to provide automated scanning, deliver faster feedback to your devs earlier on in the software development lifecycle. And then Burp Suite Pro is going to be used for that more targeted manual testing. In fact, the majority of Burp Suite Enterprise Edition customers are also customers of Burp Suite Pro. If you need any further clarification, then please let me know, let the team know who are managing the Q&A. So, Alex, without further ado, over to you for scanner update.
Hi everyone. I'm going to give you a quick run through of some of the stuff we've worked on over the last year, what we're currently working on, and what we've got to look forward to towards the end of this year and into the start of next year. So that said, I'll start with looking at what we've done in 2022. So it's kind of been a very, very busy year for us actually on the scanner team. As you can see from this, we had lots of cool features that we've delivered. Kind of starting back in February in our 2022 release, we had a big push at the start of the year around kind of optimizations for single page apps. We initially added detection for single page apps which use URL fragments. We've also added our first feature for single page apps where we intercept any API calls that the single page front end were making and send those to audit. So that's kind of greatly improved our coverage of single page apps there. We also did a bit of performance tweaking for the fastest mode. We realized that actually everything isn't a single page app these days. There are still static sites out there that need to be audited. So we made some changes that we dubbed Incy Wincy Crawler as a nod back to the old spider from Burp 1.7, which should greatly improve the speed that we scan static sites with. Moving on a bit later into March, we had our 0.3 release. We did a bit of a push again on the dynamic JavaScript analysis. The initial release of that we released way back with Bert 2 actually. It only ever looked at the static page that we found from the crawler, and it didn't. If the page needed any API calls or resources to be loaded, they weren't being loaded as part of the dynamic analysis phase, which meant we probably missed quite a few vulnerabilities. So we did a good improvement there, whereby when we're in the dynamic analysis phase in the audit, we will load any dynamic content into the page and before we run the dynamic analysis checks. Moving on a bit later into the year, into May. And 2022.5, we did some work and added some new scan checks for JSON Web Tokens, JWT. I think there's about five checks we did there. So we've got weak signature, failure to verify secret signatures, kind of leaked well-known weak keys. If you'd like to know any more about the JWT scan checks, please go and check our Web Security Academy. There is a whole wealth of information there where you can learn and try out some of these techniques for yourself. Another little kind of performance improvement we made here in the crawl is we added the ability to skip the unauthenticated crawl. Now this gives you fairly decent performance improvement if you're scanning sites that have predominantly most of their content behind an authentication system. So we don't bother doing the kind of unauthenticated crawl where we look around the site without trying to log in. We just favor logging in and then doing the audit, which gave people a fairly decent speed boost. Moving on to the middle of the year in June, the crawler and the audit has been hugely, hugely configurable. It's really powerful. There's a lot you can do, but we realized that actually it was almost too configurable and people were tying themselves in knots a little bit. So we did a bit of work to kind of simplify the configuration and launched some preset configs that let people basically pick whether they favored a very quick scan just to get some really early feedback and have a look into the findings, or whether they wanted a more thorough scan which was going to take a few bit longer. We also at that point added HBOM Keep Alive, another performance improvement for sites that don't use HTTP2. It means you kind of keep the connection pool alive, so you should get fairly significant speed boost if you enable that. Later in the year, into July, we added some detection capabilities for client-side prototype pollution, which is a kind of fairly novel vulnerability class. So we've added detection capabilities to our dynamic JavaScript analyzer tool to find this class of vulnerability. We believe we were one of the first major DAS vendors to automatically detect this in their tools. In August, this was a huge release for us on the scanner side of things. It was we've been busy over most of the summer working very closely with James Kettle, based on the back of his client-side desync research. Again, if you're not familiar with this, there's a wealth of information on the labs. James's white papers are a really interesting read, if a little terrifying. And we were certainly the first vendor in the market to release this technique to the wild. So the current early adopter release we've got which came out in September, there's two sort of big ticket items from the scanner here. We've got what we're calling adaptive request throttling. This is handling HTTP/429 response code. So if the server's telling us to throttle, traditionally we would have just carried on regardless and tried to audit. So we've built a capability in now to kind of throttle ourselves and slow down a bit, so we respect the throttling messages coming from the server, which means we've got a much, much better chance of the payloads actually hitting the back ends on the websites and ending up where they're supposed to, instead of being stopped by a load balancer or something. And the other huge item in this, which we've been working really, really hard on for 6 months, a year nearly, is we've completely written the extender API. At the minute, we are feature parity with the existing extender API, but we're in a position now to actually start building out a wealth of new features into that. So that, you know, watch this space on this. There's many, many more things coming over the next 6 to 12 months with the new extension API. So we can have the next slide, please, Alex. So what are we working on at the minute? As I said a second ago, we are continuing to expand the functionality of the new extender API. I believe WebSocket support is coming next, along with a few other things. We are busy working on the stability and reliability with our single page apps. This is a very hard problem. We're spending a lot of time and money on trying to make it the best in the market. I think we're doing pretty well, but there's still a way to go. And we've also spent a lot of time on trying to re-engineer our integration with the Chrome web browser that we use. Initially, the function we're trying to support is to support pop-ups when in recorded logins. We've never had the ability to handle pop-ups correctly in recorded login sequences. So hopefully in the next couple of months, we will be able to support pop-ups. It also kind of helps us address some issues we have when kind of determining if a page is ready in a single page app. It's very hard to kind of tell whether things are loaded and settled down. So there's a lot of work going on behind the scenes for us to kind of simplify and make this code fit for purpose going forward. Hopefully at the back of this as well, we're actually going to see some fairly significant memory and CPU overhead because we're re-engineering the way we're talking with the browser, and hopefully we should need many fewer browser processes going forward. And the next slide, please, Alex. So again, what have we got coming up next? So we're going to carry on with our single page app support. Once we've got the browser integration re-engineering work done, we are going to start looking again at our React and Angular coverage. So at the minute, we don't do a great job with input elements that are not enclosed with a form tag, which is fairly common in single page apps. So there's going to be a lot of work done there just to try and make the React coverage like rock solid, because it's by far the most popular single page app framework. After that, we're going to start looking and targeting any specific things we can do for the other popular but less popular frameworks such as Angular and Vue, just chipping away with those over the rest of the year. That should take us up to kind of December into the start of the new year. And one thing I'm particularly excited about is we're working on a new declarative scan check framework. So this is going to go hand in hand with the extender API. But hopefully be a lot simpler and really lower the barrier to entry for people to be able to write their own custom scan checks in Burp. So I don't know many of you might be familiar with a product called Nuclei by Project Discovery. So we're taking a lot of inspiration from that. The scan check templates will be basically little YAML files where you can describe in quite a simple English-like language what you want to do. You'll send this request, look for this response, and raise the issue. And these will be first-class citizen scan checks within Burp. Initially, we'll be rolling out this to Pro. The target is to roll this out towards the end of the year for December or January. And then we'll be following up with support for that in Enterprise Edition. So thank you very much for your time.
Alex, thank you. Fantastic update on all things Burp Scanner. I'm sure we'll welcome you back in 2023 with another update. So thanks very much. If there's any questions for Alex today that haven't been covered, please drop them in the Q&A box. And if we don't get around them today, we'll certainly follow up via email after the event.
Over to you, Alex.
Thank you. So before we get going into the demo, it's useful to cover how Burp Suite Enterprise Edition is licensed. Appreciate this might appear like quite a dry topic to concentrate on, but it's something that we always get asked on nearly every customer call. The main reason being is that if you're using a competitor solution, currently we are unique in the fact that we charge per concurrent scan and not per application. So what does that mean? We don't limit you on the number of apps, domains, URLs, users to that fact, or anything else, only scan concurrency. So the number of scans running at the same time, those scans can be assigned and reassigned across an unlimited number of URLs. On the back of that, the sort of next common question that we get asked is, how many concurrent scans do I need if I'm not being charged per app? So we ask customers to think about the number of apps that they have or the number of apps that they know about. How often do you need to scan? Do you have a specific scan window? So can you only scan at weekends? Can you only scan in the evenings or overnight? And also, do you have a specific budget? So companies with large web portfolios that need to scan frequently will have more scanning resources than small companies who are just starting out with automated scanning. That's an obvious thing to say. But if we look at an example, so you've got 500 apps across your organization. Some may be public-facing apps that have got daily dev work going on. Some may be internal apps that are more stable and possibly only have work going on maybe every quarter. But whatever the combination, you're probably not going to be scanning all of those apps every single day. More realistically, you'll be hitting maybe 50 apps on a daily basis with a combination of scheduled scans and scans triggered by your CI/CD pipeline of choice. So assuming that your scans fit into a working day, you would only need to purchase, in this instance, a 50 concurrent scan license. If you kicked off more scans than you had available, so you were running 50 and you kicked off the 51st, that would just be queued until a resource was free. What does that look like in terms of pricing? We're incredibly transparent at Portswigger, so it's worth doing a slide on it. Pricing is direct on the website, but Portswigger Enterprise Edition license with one concurrent scan, which is obviously the minimum you can have, $5,999. Each additional concurrent scan thereafter is $599. So in the example that we've just discussed, Portswigger Enterprise Edition license with 50 concurrent scans would be $35,350. And to reinforce what I just said in the previous slide, this subscription, in theory, could scan an unlimited number of applications. You would have to have them waiting for a while, but it is possible. That's based on a 12-month subscription. We do offer multi-year, right up to 10-year, if that's what your organisation wants. So I'm going to hand over to Alex. Please remember, if you've got any questions, make sure that you're adding in the Q&A box. We've got the team working behind the scenes. So Alex, over to you.
Cheers, Adam. So, guys, we'll just go over the architecture side of Enterprise first, and then we'll move into the demo, as Adam mentioned. Keep the questions coming. So Enterprise will look architecturally quite different to Professional, if that's what you're used to from a tool perspective. So we have different core components that comprise Enterprise and then a few different ways of deploying that. So in terms of user access, either by individual users themselves or perhaps an API client, that's going to communicate over the web server. Then we'll have the enterprise server itself, which handles all of the business logic behind the scenes. And then one or more scanning machines, which are the entities that actually perform the scans against your target applications. Think of these as your automated penetration testers. Every component will connect to some form of SQL database for which there is a number of choices around. With those deployment options, option one, and currently probably the most popular, is just our standard installer. So this is taking our installer from the release page and deploying it against an OS of your choice. That's Windows, various flavors of Linux, Mac OS. But essentially, if your machine is 64-bit and can run Java, you're pretty much good to go. And then you've got the choice of either deploying that all to one machine, so single machine deployment, that's good for trial or POC purposes. And then the multi-system deployment, which we'll talk about in a second. If your preference is more around containerization, then we do have the Kubernetes deployment available. So we provide the Helm charts for which you can deploy the application. Again, the idea here is that we're being fairly agnostic. So we should support any x86-based cluster, regardless of what that underlying setup looks like. And then with Kubernetes and the containerization element, you benefit from the auto-scaling scanning machines, which we'll cover off in a sec. So the standard installer single machine deployment will look like this. So if you imagine this is a virtual machine, all of those components live together. Again, this is ideal for a trial or a POC purpose where you're just testing Enterprise out. You can see the various connections ongoing. So the users coming into the web server will access portswigger.net for licensing activation. If you're a pro user, you'll be familiar with Burp Collaborator. So that works in exactly the same way with Enterprise. And of course, our target websites. For a multi-system deployment, this is going to be typical for your production instance effectively. So if we use the same analogy of everything belonging to a VM, the web server and enterprise server will live together on a single virtual machine. You can deploy our bundled H2 database. Typically, customers tend to use their own external database, which will sit on its own virtual machine typically as well. And then one or more scanning machines, which are also deployed to their own servers. And this is where the notion of scale comes from with Enterprise. So each server, depending on their specification, can support X number of concurrent scans. That's all documented on our website. And from a connectivity perspective, this is all the same, except that scanning machine needs to talk back to the Enterprise server in the database. But you can deploy scanning machines into other networks, providing you can maintain those connections. So if you're interested in Kubernetes, you just need to meet these three pre-requirements in order to deploy. And that should mean you can deploy to AWS as your GCP private, just as long as you meet these pre-requirements. So some sort of ingress solution, that's typically going to be a load balancer or an ingress controller. You'll need a persistent volume claims, that's application name, i.e. whatever you give it, dash PVC. And that must be shared by all the nodes in the namespace. And then for the auto-scaling, the cluster auto-scaler must be installed and enabled. This means we don't need to pre-provision our scanning machines like we do with a standard installer. Every time we either create a scan or a scan is created from a schedule, a scan job is launched and then the pod will be created. It'll scan the target application and then be killed off. So from a resource perspective, this is much more efficient and very suitable to larger environments as well. So what the architecture of the Kubernetes deployment looks like, and we've kind of split the responsibilities to each side. So you'll be looking after, or rather deploying the web service ingress and database, although we do have scripts for the database deployment and examples of the web service, and then the Helm chart will deploy essentially everything else, with the scanner pod being looked after by the enterprise server. Without further ado, we'll jump into the demo, guys. So assuming you have deployed, the actual installation will look the same, and we'll just log in here. So you can see there we do support SSO, so you've got a preference for LDAP or SAML, that's fully supported. Once you have deployed, the premise is very straightforward with enterprise. It's very much a kind of point and click solution. So we want to create target sites. These are our applications that we want to scan. As Adam mentioned, we don't limit you as to how many sites you want to create. And then we will typically run some form of scan schedule against those sites. So if we jump into sites here, we can see we've got some pre-created already or distributed into folders. As a new installation, you might have a lot of sites that you need to kind of bring in. So you can use our import site feature by completing the CSV template. That's going to go ahead and populate all of those sites for you. I'll just give you a sense of what creating a site looks like. So we give it a name. We can assign everything into folders. So we might distribute by team or geographical location, staging versus prod. Choice is entirely up to you. Then the important bit is our site scope. So we need to give a target effectively for us to reach out to. So this is going to be the highest level URL that you all want to include for that scan. And then all subdirectories will be scanned by default. This is going to be HTTP or S, or you can use and specify just one of those protocols if required. If we need to be more specific in terms of what we're scanning from a URL perspective, we can use the include or exclude URLs. So maybe we want to call out a specific API endpoint, for example, or maybe exclude something that we don't want to include for the purposes of scanning. We can do so. As I mentioned, everything is done at the site level, so that includes things like our scan configuration, application logins, and extensions. So Alex mentioned earlier that we've introduced the preset scan mode. So these are great just for getting started very quickly, fairly self-explanatory in terms of what those presets are. So from a lightweight 15-minute scan all the way to the deep, which is more thorough in terms of that crawl and audit that you're going to achieve. But you do still have the ability to customize your own scan configurations. We've got even more pre-built ones in the library, or you can just create one from scratch if you're looking to do something very specific. Applications that need authentication, you've got two choices. So we can pass username and password as part of the scan. The crawler will use this every time it wants to log in or locates that submission form. Very useful just for single page, very basic login forms. Anything more complex, we would typically use the recorded login sequence. This is a plugin in our browser, and that lets us record the process of logging into our application in an incognito session that will generate a series of events in JSON form, and we can cut and paste that into our configuration. And again, the crawler will use this every time it wants to authenticate against that application. So great for anything more advanced like SSO multi-form type login. Extensions are also supported. So if you're familiar with the BAP store, you can add your extensions on a site basis here. We've got documentation in terms of the extensibility API, so if you want to create your own as well, that's certainly still possible. Now that we've created our site, we can go ahead and scan it. So if you go to new scan, we now have our populated site tree. So we'll select the site we want to scan. And then typically we're going to schedule that scan to start a particular date and time, and then we can repeat it on our desired basis. Perhaps that's forever, a set number of times, or until a particular date. Maybe we want lightweight daily scans, something more thorough at the weekend. Choice is entirely yours. Just for the purpose of the demo, I'll just run this on an ad hoc basis. So start now and run it just the once. If I had configured any email recipients for that site configuration, they would also receive a copy of that report at the end of the scan. Once that scan starts, I can then use the timeline to monitor the scans. This represents each phase that I go through. So assigning it to an available scanning machine, the scan starts, then enter the crawl, followed by the audit phase. It'll start to give me detail around the URLs that are being scanned, requests that are made, and then once we're auditing the actual issues. I just jump into a scan that's already run. This is what a completed scan looks like. And the idea with Enterprise is that we're building that picture over time of our kind of security posture for that given application. And I can start to drill down into those particular issues that are being found. So everything is categorized by its severity and its confidence level. And I can filter on that basis and then select the specific URL where that issue was found. And I'll be presented with my advisory. I can get issue detail and background information on the particular vulnerability. There'll be some remediation advice, typically some form of reference to our Web Security Academy, which Alex mentioned. So this is even more detail about those vulnerabilities, a sandbox environment to carry out the similar sort of payloads, and then our classifications for the CWEs as well. I can also inspect our request and the response for the payload, and then if after further evaluation, perhaps even some manual testing in professional, I determine that this is actually a false positive. I can mark it as such. And if I want that to propagate into future scans, I can do so for the site or more specifically the URL. If I've got any interest in issue tracking, I can also do this here. So for example, here I've got Jira ticket creation enabled. This can either be manual or automatic. So based on that severity level, if it was automated, an issue would have been raised for me, or I can do it manually as well. Once I've kind of got to grips with the sort of 101 scanning of Enterprise, creating sites, running my scans, you can start to build out your implementation. So from a team perspective, and this very much is a team-based product, it's all role-based access control, so I can create my users and assign them to groups, and they have very specific roles and functions. So maybe some read-only type roles for reporting, maybe they're maintaining the site, maybe they're initiating scans. Choice is entirely yours as to how you carve that out. If I jump into the integrations tab, we can see here what's available in terms of issue tracking. So Jira, GitLab, and Trello. We've also added Slack. So this is notifications around scanning, start, failed, issues, completed, etc. For user integration, if I don't want to manage those users locally, as we mentioned at the start, we've got the SAML integration and LDAP. So if you want to pass existing groups over and manage them that way, that's absolutely fine. If you just want to use those for authentication only and you have a SCIM module, you can also manage your users via SCIM as well. Beyond those integrations, quite a large use case for BIP Suite Enterprise is the CI/CD scanning. So we achieve this currently via the use of a driver. So we're giving the awareness to the pipeline of what the scan is doing, so we can fail the build based on what the scan is finding. So I'll just give an example in Jenkins, but this does work across really any platform as long as it can run the jar file, which is what the Java is. So if you're running on a different platform, the premise and what's happening under the hood is exactly the same as within Jenkins. It's just more of a scriptable fashion. So if I jump into my example here, and then I'll go to configure. Once the driver is installed into the example of Jenkins, I'm going to receive some additional build steps that I can add that the driver provides. So you can see here, we're going to perform a site-driven scan which I've inserted as a build step. We connect to our enterprise server by the URL, and then we provide the API key that's generated from an API user. Once those are correct and authenticated, I can then populate my sitemap. I can retrieve the specific site that I want to scan. Again, this is a site-driven scan, so it's pulling all of that configuration information from the site level that I've already set. So I only need to say, when do I want the build to fail based on the severity, and a confidence level. I can permit a certain number of issues, certificate if required, and then if I'm a developer and maybe I don't even have access as a user to Burp Suite Enterprise, but I'm interacting with the API, I can say where I want that report generated as well. Once that's done, it's just a case of running the build. That will say an API-based scan request to Enterprise. So if I jump in here, I can see that's now been accepted and is queuing, waiting for a free scanning machine. Based on what is found, we have that awareness with the build where we can determine where the scan is up to and if we need to fail it based on what we're finding. So again, if you use a different platform, Bitbucket as your DevOps, whatever the case may be, the exact same process is followed. So we have a script that's documented in our documentation. We can build that out with the optional parameters around how we fail a build. Do we want reports generating, pass certificates, etc. The process works exactly the same. Folks, that's it in terms of the demo. Again, if you've got any questions, please fire those into the chat. And of course, if you want to get kind of hands-on, there is the trial license available for Enterprise as well.
Brilliant. Thanks very much, Alex. Just a quick recap on what is left on the 2022 roadmap. Obviously, 3 months ago, busy, busy engineers, but I've pulled out three things here. Our roadmap is publicly available. There's a great blog post on our site that documents all of the roadmap items that have been added and that are work in progress for Enterprise Edition Pro and for the Burp Scanner, covering some of the things that Alex Borschik mentioned today. But picked out three things here for Enterprise Edition that I know will be of particular interest to some customers. So we've got the replay of recorded login sequences. So that work's underway on making it possible to view the recorded login sequence within the UI that's been executed during the scan, so that you can test their operation, make sure it's working as expected, a feature that we've long been pushing for and look forward to getting into product. We've got CI/CD inversion of control. What do we mean by that? So we're hoping to enable users to start an Enterprise Edition scanning machine in a container that's going to be controlled by a CI system. So this will make it possible to run scans within temporary environments that are not previously accessible by Enterprise Edition scanning machines. And finally, the export of scan results in Burp's XML format. So at present, we've got HTML export from Enterprise Edition, but this is going to enable users to export scan results in XML form, enabling easier integration with systems such as Defect Dojo or other high street vulnerability management tools. Next slide, please. Finally, mentioned it on the agenda. It wasn't mentioned when we sent the invite out, but something we thought was worth shouting about. So earlier this year, we quietly launched our new deliberately vulnerable website, the Gin and Juice Shop. This site is filled with the sort of features that you'd expect. So single-use CSRF tokens, plenty of JavaScript, etc. Our ask is that you point Burp and your existing or existing automated scanner or potentially an automated scanner that you're evaluating at the Gin and Juice Shop to test whether it's able to map the attack surface and find real vulnerabilities. It would be fantastic to hear what you find. So as we move on to Q&A, by the looks of it, it's been a little bit quiet in the Q&A box today. We've had a couple of reasonably technical questions, which I think if they're not applicable for the whole audience, maybe we answer those and we'll send that to everyone that's attended via email. We've got a couple in here, Alex, if you want to have a quick scan. Any plans to support Azure DevOps issue tracker?
So yes, that is potentially on our roadmap. We do get a lot of requests for Azure DevOps. I believe GitHub is likely to be next, and that should probably be followed by Azure.
Cool. Also got, how long does a scan typically take? Is there an average amount of time? Almost the unanswerable question. So scan times obviously vary. There's no typical average that we're able to deliver back because it's unique to your application. their scan time is determined by the size and complexity and nature of the application, and also the scan configuration used as per the preset scan configs that Alex demonstrated earlier. You can reduce that down. You can set something that has a limited crawl and audit time, for example, but the scan will take the period of time that it requires to fully navigate your application unless it's told otherwise. Is offline activation supported in Berkshire Enterprise Edition as another question? Unfortunately not, as it is with Pro, you do need a connection back to ps.net. You can remove that after activation, but a fully offline activation without a connection back to us is not available. Let me have a quick look what else we've got. One that's appropriate to answer now, Alex, or would you prefer to cover that off over email?
MFA supports one. Okay. It is something we're aware of. Other customers have asked. It's not on the immediate roadmap. I think the best thing to do would probably be to just get in touch with support, and they'll log your feature request. And as more and more people get in touch, then it's going to bump up the priority. So. But it is something we're aware of, and it is technically possible to do. So it's something we would like to do in the future, yes.
Great stuff. Thanks very much. Well, as I said, we'll curate all of those questions that have been asked today, and we'll send that back over email for everyone that's attended. So what happens next? We'll say we'll follow up with the Q&A and the recording. We'll send a link to our YouTube channel, which we should have that updated by the end of the week, possibly early next week. And our ask, if you've previously evaluated Berkshire Enterprise Edition, do you want to take another look? We're more than happy to support you. Are you currently trialing? Do you need any support? Are you aware of all the capabilities of the product? Do you need myself or any of the other advocates to help you along that journey? And are you an existing customer? And this is a bit of a different one, really. But what we find often is we're speaking to large global organizations that a small team has adopted Enterprise Edition. And is there anything that you can do to help us roll that out across the organization? We're obviously seeing the benefit of it if you're using it as part of your process. So if there's anything we can do to help, maybe running similar sessions like this for wider teams in your organization, then please let us know. Best way to get in contact, either reply to the emails that we're going to send out post-event, or hello@portswigger.net, and just pop portswiggernr in the subject line. Unless there are any other open Q&As, which I don't think they are, we will wrap up today. So thank you very much for attending, and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Thanks very much.
Thanks all.